Janet Lomax, Gabe Dalmuth, meteorologist John Hambleton, and Rich Funke on sports. This is News Team 10.
Good evening. An Eastern deal has finally taken off. The agreement between the airline and a group of investors headed by Peter Uberoth.
It's a $464 million purchase with plenty of strings attached. Steve Scully has been looking into the deal and is here tonight with more on how it will affect Rochester travelers. Steve?
Gabe, Janet, the announcement came this afternoon in New York City. Former baseball commissioner Peter Uberoth wants to take a swing at managing an airline. If his deal works out, he could take control later this month, restoring service and pride a month after the walkout began. Outside, the pickets were back at the Rochester International Airport. One last attack against Eastern owner Frank Lorenzo. Inside, Eastern's ticket counter remains empty. Many of its Atlanta-bound passengers have switched to Delta.
After Delta came into the picture, we had no problem. Delta satisfied these people.
With Lorenzo at his side, Peter Uberoth announced what he's calling a new kind of airline.
The name of the company is interesting, and it really kind of says it all. Eastern Airlines Employees and Service Corporation.
Under that plan, Uberoth and his partner would own 30% of Eastern. The employees would own another 30%, and investors would have stake in the remaining 40%. Word of the deal spread fast.
Eastern has had its problems in the past, and I hope this solves them.
It's good to see Eastern flying again.
But two Rochester area Eastern employees on strike for the past month are a little more cautious.
Until I see the sale actually in ink and the ink dried, I'm still skeptical.
Our membership is telling us just not to get too excited until it's complete.
And for passengers, there's another question. Will the new Eastern service Rochester?
Oh, I think so, yes. Rochester's a very important town. Above, I think, beyond its actual size because of the amount of business here.
And there's still a few other hurdles to overcome. Eastern must get approval from bankruptcy court. And Gabe, they also must reach an agreement on those concessions with its unions.
How soon will Eastern be back in business now?
This afternoon, Frank Lorenzo says within 24 hours. But to be realistic, it could be a few weeks before even somewhat normal service is restored. It's going to take a while.
All right. Thanks, Steve.
President Bush was mentioned today in the trial of Oliver North. The White House is not commenting on a statement read in the trial today. It said George Bush, then vice president, acted as a messenger for President Reagan during the Iran-Contra affair. The statement said Bush told Honduran leaders that extra U.S. aid was on its way because of their help with the Contras.
Is $1 million enough to keep Sterling Drug in New York State? That's the incentive package being offered to the company by local leaders in Rensselaer County. Sterling employs about 950 people at its plant there, but is considering moving its operations to Pennsylvania. Sterling was purchased by Kodak last year. Now other stories around town tonight.
Kodak is planning new expansion. This time it's on vacant land near Kodak Park West. The company wants to team up with a developer from Syracuse to build office space, a recreation center, and a hotel. Mary Gilmore, the woman who was a fugitive in Wayne County and allowed to return there on parole, is again in trouble with the law. State police say she'd been smoking marijuana behind the wheel and was speeding. The Rochester School Board tonight gave out awards to kids who published this book called Drugs Aren't Cool. All students and parents will get the books. Stories around town tonight.
Ruth Scott, a longtime member of City Council, is stepping down. She announced today she will not run again, but instead will spend more time with her family and with business interests. Scott is currently the council's vice president. A new health care plan designed to help older Americans may instead be a problem for many of them. David Biggie was out tonight learning about the growing fight against the catastrophic health care bill.
Janet, maybe you remember the catastrophic health care bill. At one time, it was heralded as one of the most progressive pieces of legislation ever to help our nation's elderly. But now older folks are looking at the fine print and saying the health care bill isn't what it's cracked up to be.
For weeks, Helen Brock and Vince Zazzo have been rallying local seniors trying to get them organized against the government's new catastrophic health care bill. In their minds, the bill will cost seniors more money and give them less health care.
It was something that was like a bomb that was dropped on us without any preparation, no information, no anything about it that would help us learn to accept the situation.
their concerns first on coverage. They say the bill does not include nursing home care, something many seniors need the most. They're also concerned about costs. To finance the plan, seniors alone will shoulder a 15% surcharge on their regular taxes, a charge that will grow to 28% by 1993. Seniors call that a tax on a tax, one they can ill afford, especially on fixed incomes.
As a small segment of society, we are being taxed upon a tax which has really never been heard of in this country before.
Local Assemblyman Robert King also opposes the federal bill and is trying to persuade New York lawmakers to send a message to Washington.
The type of care that is covered in this bill is care that most seniors don't need.
We should also point out that our local Congressman Frank Horton was one of the original sponsors of legislation attempting to repeal the catastrophic health care bill, and we're told that that effort is now picking up steam in Washington.
But what are the chances of actually overturning it? What are the chances?
Well, even supporters of this repeal effort say that their chances are slim to none, but they're going to go ahead with this fight anyway.
All right. David, thank you.
When older people get depressed, it's often natural to turn to their children for help, but this may only make matters worse. Dr. Dean Adell explains in our Health Concerns segment.
For some mental health professionals, it's become the number one cause of depression in their patients.
It is so common that we say, oh, it's another case of move close to son or daughter.
Dr. Peterson is talking about the propensity of many seniors who are retired to pull up roots and move to where their grown kids live. But unlike the parents' old neighborhood, the new environment, except for the kids, is foreign.
They don't know him at the grocery store. They don't know him where he takes his dry cleaning. And he has to break into a whole new system, and it's very hard.
So the parents and some of the offspring become depressed, some of them seriously. Fortunately, Dr. Peterson and her colleagues have been successful in treating this depression through either therapy, antidepressive medication, or a combination of both. Even patients in their 90s have shown remarkable improvement.
We've been doing this form of treatment now for close to 10 years, and we found that overall, the success rate is about 7 out of 10 people.
So the message is clear. If you're thinking of moving near your kids, think twice. And if you're already having psychological problems, see a mental health professional. I'm Dr. Dean Adell.
Anytime you need help in coping, think of Lifeline 275-5151.
Next from News Team 10, the name stays the same.
But you'll see a change on the dial in just a short while.
We think we can better report, especially in the Northeast and in particular with our station in Albany, on New York State News.
I'm John Hambleton. WeatherTrack shows one system moving out, but we're watching another take shape. What does it mean for us? We'll tell you in a minute.
Number one primetime network, NBC. TV 10 Vice President and General Manager Arnold Klinsky says the move will offer viewers the best in television programming and will strengthen our local news. The change to NBC will allow TV 10 to take advantage of other stations in the Northeast that our parent company Viacom owns, which are also NBC affiliates.
Because all the networks, I'm certain, will be broadcast in Rochester. People can still see all of their favorite programs. It gives us an opportunity, first of all, to link with a very strong network, but more importantly, to do some things that we think will enhance our ability to serve the community, especially by reporting news.
Now, for those of you who've been calling the News Team 10 hotline, here's how all of this will work. We will remain WHEC Channel 10 on your dial. The NBC shows will leave Channel 8 and come here. We expect that CBS will join up with another station in Rochester. TV 10 will offer network programming in stereo. Again, the change takes place later this year.